The Philippines logged 1,766 new COVID infections Thursday, the second day in a row that the number of fresh cases was below 2,000. 239 more patients have died, while over 2,000 more recovered. Active cases now stand at 37,000, the lowest since March 7. The Okta Research Group says the continuous decline in infections suggests the surge of infections brought by the Delta variant has been reversed.
The reversal, yes. There were still surges happening in other provinces at that time. But hopefully, fortunately, right now we're able to contain, I think almost all provinces are on a downward trend.
This is hopeful because it means that, you know, the virus is really weakening. It's weakening, especially in these areas.
The National Capital Region is placed under alert level 2 as COVID-19 infections fall. The loser quarantine takes effect today, Friday, until November 21st. According to the guidelines of the Interagency Task Force, intervenues are now allowed to accept a maximum of 50% capacity for fully vaccinated individuals as well as minors, regardless of their vaccination status. Capacity in outdoor venues, on the other hand, will be raised to up to 70%. Karaoke bars, clubs, concert halls, and theaters may also reopen. Meanwhile, government offices and agencies are now allowed to have up to 50% on-site capacity. The IATF says that starting December, alert level assignments will be determined every 15th and 30th of the month. The government may escalate the alert level at any time within the implementation, while de-escalations can only be done at the end of the two-week assessment period.
The Interior Department set to recommend the lifting of face shield requirements in the Philippines. Undersecretary Jonathan Malaya says the DILG will bring up the recommendation to the Interagency Task Force. Currently, face shields are required in enclosed and crowded spaces. Talks about lifting the mandate were revived as the COVID-19 situation in the country continues to improve.
We will recommend to the IATF na dahan-dahan na natin tanggalin yung face shield as a requirement, except of course in hospital settings. High-risk environment yan, sa tingin po namin sa DILG, required pa din kailangan ang paggamit ng face shield. But in other instances, sa tingin po namin ay pwede na pong luwagan ang pulisiyang yan. But at the end of the day, you said it will be the decision of the IATF.
The Interior Department also set to hold an emergency meeting with heads of local governments to discuss how to speed up COVID-19 vaccination in the provinces. That's after President Rodrigo Duterte warned local leaders may be sanctioned if their area continues to lag in administrating COVID jabs. 8 months into the Philippines' inoculation drive, only Metro Manila is fully vaccinated more than half of the target 70% of its population. The Cordillera Administrative Region has the highest vaccination rate outside Metro Manila with 39%. The Bangsamoro Region is dead last, having inoculated just 9.8% of its target as officials struggle to combat vaccine hesitancy. Bicol ranked second to the last with 19% of its target receiving a complete dose.
Natawag po natin lahat ng ating mga gobernador at and city mayor sa isang pagpupulong para masabi sa kanila yung mga dapat gawin para ma-fast track yung pagbabakuna. Wala na pong excuse na sasabihin natin walang bakuna dahil sobra-sobra po ang bakuna on the ground. Magkakaroon ng tinatawag natin catch-up plan na manggagaling sa lokal na gobyerno na sa kanila talaga ang talaan ng pagbabakuna dahil nasa kanila yung tinatawag nating local logistics, no, for purposes of vaccination.
A village in the city of Davao drops its no vaccine, no transaction policy just a day after it was implemented. The village chairman of Kabantian said he thought of the rule to encourage residents to get vaccinated against COVID-19. But after receiving much backlash, he stopped the implementation and took to Facebook to apologize, saying he only wanted to protect his community.
State medical insurer PhilHealth vows to settle the claims of private hospitals this month. PhilHealth insists it has enough funds to pay the claims, but there are some delays due to manpower issues and some errors in documents. It adds it has paid some 152 billion pesos from January 2020 until October 28, which represents 75% of all claims it has received.
lubos po nating nauunawaan ang kalagayan po at yung idinulot po nito sa ating mga partner hospitals. Humihingi po kami ng kaunti pang pangunawa at suporta, at sa moving forward ay matatanggap na po nila yun pong mga bayad na nabinbin sa mga nakaraan. Kami po ay umaasa na kung may mga plano man po ang ilan sa ating mga ospital na mag-disengage, no, mula sa PhilHealth, sana po ma-reconsider po nila ito.
The Private Hospitals Association of the Philippines earlier said most claims for the treatment of COVID-19 patients since last year remain unpaid, amounting to around 834 million pesos. Some private hospitals are considering to cut ties with PhilHealth over the issue.
On to the Philippine Senate's probe into government's allegedly anomalous pandemic spending. The Blue Ribbon Committee cites in contempt the former head of the Budget Department's Procurement Service, Lloyd Christopher Lau, for failing to attend hearings. Lau was at the helm when the Health Department transferred 42 billion pesos to the PSDBM, which bought allegedly overpriced medical supplies from formerly pharmaceutical.
He's been appearing and has escaped. I don't think we need to ask for a show cause order to him why he should not be declared in contempt. He's still needed here because he's got a lot to explain as well.
Key formerly officials Twinkle and Mohit Dargani, who have also been cited in contempt, were still a no-show. Health officials, including Secretary Francisco Duque, were also absent due to a memo barring cabinet members from attending Senate hearings. Senator Richard Gordon believes President Rodrigo Duterte does not want his people to take part in the proceedings, so his name will not be dragged into the controversy.
The delay is caused not by the Senate Blue Ribbon Committee, but by the president himself, who has not only been consistently defending his people, I don't know why, defending Michael Young, a Chinese economic advisor of his, defending Lau, an appointee of his, Mr. Leong, and all these other people, and has now told his cabinet members, I don't know for what reason, he refuses to send them to us, right? Or no valid reason. And so therefore, I think we should assert that before the Department of Justice, and I understand that we are almost ready to file something in the Supreme Court.
Meanwhile, Farmalee's tax deficiencies were again scrutinized by senators. Tax expert Mona Brea told Thursday Senate hearing, Farmalee has 3.4 billion pesos worth of purchases undeclared to the Bureau of Internal Revenue, or BIR. That's out of the 7.2 billion pesos worth of total purchases. Abrea, who is a BIR consultant, said the non-declaration could be a ground for tax evasion.
Mr. Chairman. Maraming salamat po, Mr. Chairman. Audited FS bilang purchases, Mr. Chairman. Kaya po siguro dapat po ang tanungin po natin yung gumawa ng FS, saan ang galing yung 3.4 billion dahil sa kanilang summary list of purchases, 3.2 billion lamang, at sa kanilang summary list of importations mula sa Bureau of Customs, nasa 600 million lamang po ang importation. Lumalabas, 3.8 billion lamang po ang na-report sa BIR at Customs.
Senate Minority Leader Franklin Rilon said Farmalee's records could be considered as false entries, which is punishable by imprisonment. Foreigners involved can also be deported.
Blue Ribbon Committee members in the Senate denounced the alleged harassment of Mon Abrea, the tax expert helping them analyze the financial records of Farmalee Corporation. Abrea revealed on Thursday that a complainant is asking the Professional Regulation Commission to revoke his license as a certified public accountant. Abrea shared with ANC the commission's letter, which identified the complainant as a certain Felix Acevedo. Senator Francis Panginan is pushing for a Senate resolution to denounce the complaint as mere harassment.
We file a sense of the Senate resolution assailing such harassment and urging the PRC to dismiss or to avoid or prevent any such harassment suits on the basis precisely of Mr. Abrea's involvement in terms of providing us guidance as to better understand the ins and outs of the accounting.
Michael Yang, a former advisor to Philippine President Duterte, again on the hot seat of the Senate's probe of the government's pandemic deals. Senate Blue Ribbon Committee Chairman Richard Gordon focused on Yang's activities when he first arrived in the Philippines with a tourist visa. Gordon accused Yang of violating visa rules by engaging in business in the country at that time. Gordon also noted Yang failed to pay any income taxes. Yang now holds a permanent visa. But Gordon says he will ask the Immigration Bureau to check on Yang's supposed visa violation.
Mr. Yang, from the very beginning that you set forth here, you abuse the generosity of this country. You are a guest. Bisita ka ng bansa as a tourist. Dinilate mo yun, hindi ka nagbabayad ng buwis. Nagninegosyo ka rito.
An executive of Formally Pharmaceuticals or Formally Biologicals explains how her family is able to live in upscale neighborhoods and own luxury vehicles. Rose Nono Lin, corporate treasurer and corporator of the company, told senators most of her 100 million pesos worth of holdings comes from her Chinese husband, who was rich even before they became married. Lin says they rent homes in many upscale neighborhoods, though she herself is a permanent resident of Quezon City. She also admitted her family owns many luxury vehicles, most of which were purchased before the pandemic. Lin explains her husband is a car enthusiast, and changing vehicles is common in their family.
Pag umuwi po ako sa bahay, minsan nagugulat na lang po ako na may sasakyan. Magugulat rin po ako na wala na po yung sasakyan.
Bakit? Binibili siya ni Lin, Wiso?
Parang ginagawa po niya itong may mga kaibigan po sana na magustuhan po yung sasakyan ni namin. Dahil hindi po ako mahilig sa sasakyan. Okay na po sa akin, basta po tumatak po at may masakyan po o papunta po sa ito.
Lin is also an officer in many of the companies she and her Chinese husband are part of. These allegedly have ties with former Duterte advisor Michael Yang, a key personality in the Formally deals being questioned by the committee. Lin has said Formally Biologicals is not a sister company of Formally Pharmaceuticals.